Hello and welcome. My name is Jonathan Vita, and in this module, we will be discussing Aristotle's epistemology, that is his theory of knowledge. And we're going to look at his text, The Posterior Analytics, and specifically the section on demonstrative knowledge and its starting points. So as far as a background for Aristotle, just to get ourselves a little bit of a grasp where he fits in the history of philosophy, Aristotle kind of like made a big splash across like all of what we would might think today as the domain of knowledge. Aristotle was a student of Plato. So if you think it's Socrates, then Plato, then Aristotle. Aristotle took a lot of what Plato was teaching and tried to refine it as much as possible. But then Aristotle also had students of his own, including among them Alexander the Great, that powerful Greek conqueror that kind of like took over the West and at that time known world from the West's perspective. So that includes like a good chunk of Africa and Europe and the Middle East. As a major conqueror, though, he reflected often on what he was taught by Aristotle. Now, Aristotle has touched a bunch of different domains. That includes political and military, but also biology and logic and so many others. So what we're going to be focusing on right now is on his larger import right here. So for one, Aristotle, in talking about physics, you know, matter, objects, things like that, in motion, Aristotle's views in metaphysics and physics have had such a profound impact on science that his physics dominated for almost 2,000 years. I want like that to sink in, that most people for a good chunk of known history identified themselves as following in the tradition of Aristotle. When they're trying to explain why objects move, how do they move, what can we do to explain the movement of objects, the physics was based largely on Aristotle. When you see people like Galileo and Newton and others in the scientific revolution, what you're largely seeing is them trying to address problems with Aristotle's physics. Because up till then, it was pretty solid. Likewise, Aristotle's biology, which was focused on observation of different species and distinguishing what are their major differences. This also became the dominant science for over 2,000 years. It wasn't until around Darwin's time did people start thinking that species were not eternal and that species could develop like dramatically over time from other species. For Aristotle, his views had been the dominant one for over 2,000 years. So it's very recent, historically, that Aristotle was dethroned for biology. But also Aristotle's logic, like how to make inferences, you know, from one claim to another. So much of his work was taken, like, for granted in just how obvious and rigorous it was. And that also dominated until people were starting to refine some very precise notions. They still agree with Aristotle on the vast majority of logic, like the principle of non-contradiction, like contradictions are bad, and a bunch of other different principles. But for some kinds of inferences, that has shifted only in the last 150 years. Now, that said, for Aristotle, his metaphysics, what's our account of reality? How do we know about reality? Epistemology, like what is knowledge and how we come to understand reality, things like that, those are still influential even today. There are people who identify as Aristotelian metaphysicians or Aristotelian epistemologists. And so this means that Aristotle has been such a major force in so much of academic work for over 2,000 years. So as for a background for understanding Aristotle, one really good strategy for doing so is to look at his teacher, Plato. And so if you want to understand Aristotle's view of knowledge, it'd be helpful to kind of like think about Plato's theory of knowledge. Now, for Plato, he wants to say that if you're going to have knowledge, it's got to be about stuff that doesn't change. It's got to be something that's got to be universally true, always true, unchanging, stable. You couldn't be wrong about it. If you couldn't be wrong about it, that requires that it's about something that doesn't change. It's got to be something that you couldn't be wrong about. It's like it's certain. You couldn't be making a mistake because the world changes, or you just, it's not like justified adequately. So if you're going to have knowledge, it's going to be something that's eternally true. Now, if you're going to also distinguish like knowledge from opinion, there's a couple different ways you could do that. But one really easy way of distinguishing knowledge from just holding an opinion, something you could be wrong about, is to say that you've got justification. You can give me a reason why you hold that. And by reason, we don't mean just like you're raised to believe it, or that you just like could talk about like some causation, like, oh, well, it's because I had this happen to me, that's why I believe. What you really need is some justifications that could apply for everybody, something that would be true, and you could tell somebody and they'd be like, oh, now I understand too. Now, if you're going to have knowledge, then you need to be able to give a rational justification, one that's sufficient to actually warrant believing it. Enough reason to say, yeah, you don't just have an opinion about that. You've got something stable, something that you couldn't be wrong about. So if you think of knowledge as having some kind of ingredients, like what do I need to put together in order to have knowledge distinct from opinion or something else, it might be good to just simplify three different main ingredients. This would be the justified true belief model, JTB. It's like a formula. If you've got these three things, boom, you've got knowledge. So belief. For you to have knowledge, you got to believe what you claim to know. You have to actually believe it. You can't just think about it, but you actually have to hold it and consider it as true. You have to agree with it, assent to it, something like that. So you have to actually believe it. You have to kind of like wrap your mind around it, not just being possible, but think that it applies to the way the world is. The second is that it actually is that way in the world. If you're going to have knowledge, your belief has to be true. It has to be the way the world is, the way reality is. If you claim to have knowledge and it turns out that it was false, then you didn't really have knowledge. You just thought you had knowledge. What you really had was like an opinion and you were really confident about it. You didn't really have knowledge, because one of the requirements for having knowledge is that it actually is true. Third, you have to be justified in believing it. You could be believing something and it turns out to be true, but you could have been lucky. So one of the things that we absolutely need if we're going to be having knowledge is we need to have support and reasons for holding to the beliefs that we do. So you have to hold it because it's rational. It's what reason compelled you or led you to believe. And so if you kind of like think of it as in terms of support, then your reasons have to give good enough support for it to be not just true, but so stable and certain and necessary that you couldn't be wrong about it. So we're talking about having really, really good reasons for thinking that this is true. And what we're aiming for is something that's stable. It doesn't change. It's certain. You could have like utmost confidence about it, and necessary in that it couldn't be otherwise. It's not going to have the possibility of changing. And so if you think of this as having those three ingredients, justified, true, belief, then that is the view that Plato gives. And that's how you distinguish knowledge from opinion. So when we get to Aristotle, when it comes to knowledge, he's going to agree for the vast majority of it. But in order to do that, he gives us a building analogy. If you're thinking of knowledge, you need justification and support. But it also means that you need to get to a foundation. You need to have some basis on which all those different beliefs rest. And so knowledge has to be justified. You don't just get claims for free. You don't just get to believe whatever you want. It has to be accounted for. You have to give an account, a rational account, for why you hold what you do. And so if you hold a belief, then underneath that belief has got to be some other claim that is more stable, more certain than the belief that you hold. in a sense, then, you're looking for a foundation that's rock solid. You're looking for a foundation on which your beliefs can rest. So for any belief, you can ask this question: why is that true? And now there's a variety of different reasons that you could give. Like, there's a variety of different ways we can mean why is this true. But if you are thinking, what is the cause for this being true? What is the reason that you hold it? These are why questions. These are why questions. So for any belief, then you can kind of go down a level of depth answering this why question that supports this belief. Why do I hold this belief? Because that's the way the world is. Okay, but why? Now I can give a deeper explanation for why the world is the way that it is. And I can keep asking why and get to deeper and deeper explanations. But at some point, I need to be able to give a justification that is so stable, I don't even need to give further justification. So you need to be able to answer why questions all the way up to something that's self-evident. Something that's self-evident, where you don't need to give any further explanation. Just as soon as you think about it, it just has to be true. It's obvious. And these self-evident truths are going to be your foundation. They are your starting point for knowledge. It's on which you rest everything else. It's something that you couldn't be wrong about. And anybody who is looking at what you're looking at, whether it's like, there's no way contradictions can happen, well, that's self-evident. No one's going to disagree with that. Or at least no one should disagree with that. It's just so obvious. It is evidence of itself. You don't need further evidence to prove it. You already accept it.